Welcome to Talks at GS. I'm really pleased to be joined today by Phil Jansen, who is the Chief Executive Officer of the BT Group, based in London, one of the world's leading telecom companies. In addition to leading the BT Group through this pandemic, in March, Phil tested positive for COVID-19. Luckily, he only had mild symptoms and is now recovered. But it's a reminder that this virus has no boundaries. Phil, I really appreciate you joining us. It's good to see you looking well and healthy, and I look forward to the conversation.
Yeah, John, thanks for having me. Delighted to be here.
So let's start with your health. Talk for a second, if you would, about, you've been public about this, obviously, which is why I'm asking you about it, and you were very early in disclosing, you know, that you had it publicly. Talk about why you think it's important, why it was important to disclose it then, and why it's important to talk about it publicly now.
Well, actually, you know, two reasons. One, at the time, it was very early on, and we were still going to work. And therefore, I did ring my chief medical officer on the Monday, say, look, you know, I feel fine, but I got this little bit of a cough. What should I do? He said, well, you come to work. I happened to have, on that day, a load of meetings with government officials, cabinet ministers, and I met the whole of the industry. I mean, all the CEOs were in this meeting. So, you know, and I, the main reason I went out straight away was I wanted to make sure that everybody who came into contact with me knew about it. And there were many, many, I mean, you know, tens and tens, almost more than 100 people in that week. And that they could very quickly track down anyone who might be vulnerable. And I had my own personal worries around my mother and my mother-in-law. And I think that's really important, is to protect the people who are most vulnerable. So that's the primary reason I did it. But also just to, I think we should share our experience with people so that we all learn from things. And so I've got some friends, for example, who I talk to regularly. And one of them was very, very ill. And I encouraged them to go to hospital, and they needed to go to hospital. So I think the more that we talk about it and we learn from each other, you can spot these things that could go wrong. In my instance, for example, I at no stage did I have a raised temperature. And one of my other friends didn't have, and he thought that was a good sign, therefore he was okay, but he did have trouble breathing. And once he got to trouble breathing, I told him to go to hospital, and it's a good thing we're in hospital. He's fine. It's that kind of thing where I think we've got to keep talking about it and make sure everyone is alert and very, very vigilant, because it's got, obviously, you know, some really nasty traits to it. And if you get the wrong side of it, it can be very, very serious and lead to all the tragedies we know about.
So talk a bit about, if you would, Phil, what this crisis has taught you about leadership, about your own leadership, what you've learned. You've obviously been through other periods. I think I met you just on the back of the financial crisis when you were running WorldPay, but you've been through other crises in your career and in your life. This is a different and unique crisis, as we've talked to our own people about. Just talk about what it's taught you about leadership generally and your own leadership specifically.
So you and I remember working through some difficult times and crises in various other places. You know, they were business related, economic related, and actually they're easier, to be honest. But the principles still apply. This one is difficult because, you know, we've had people in our company die from COVID-19. We've had people who've been very, very ill, and we're dealing, you know, we're on the very much on the front line. So we've got, you know, in those 30 million customers, there are 1.5 million who are deemed vulnerable, and therefore they need to be handled very, very carefully. So that's the first thing I'd say. It's a different type of crisis. And also, I hadn't seen the economic impact and the activity ever go to a complete halt for many of our customers. And therefore, you know, no one's seen the scale of what we've dealt with here. So again, what I learned really was some of the stuff that I already knew, but in a deeper fashion. And I'll tell you what that is. I think at BT, we very, very quickly thought through how we were going to approach it. And a bit, the principles were stand by our customers, stand by our people, and stand by the country. And we're such an important part of the UK infrastructure. So those were the three elements to the rallying cry that we said we would run the company by. And then it was same old stuff, which is, stay calm, think carefully, prioritize like fury, and then be decisive. And I think, you know, in times of difficulty, people need clarity, they need direction, and they need help and assistance. So that's the first thing I'd say, is that the approach of being decisive, but also careful and considered, and not making sure that people are calm and think through things carefully, I think was really important. The other thing, which was huge for BT, was my executive team did a fantastic job. And again, you know, it's the power of people. We see that all the time. And that was another big lesson for me, is uniting the team around these three principles, if you like, and then allowing people to get on with the job. And they did extremely well. And it's whenever you have a common purpose or a common enemy, and we had both here, right? The common enemy being the virus and the impact it had on people and our business and our customers, but also the common purpose is to stand by our country, stand by our customers, stand by our people, was an amazing, a unifying force. And so as a result of that, the performance of the company has been, you know, really, really strong in very, very difficult circumstances. And I'll give you an example. You know, we answer all the emergency calls in the UK on behalf of the government, all of them. 999, it's called here. You know, you can imagine that was way, way higher than we'd experienced before. But we were 20% down on staff members because they were isolating, household isolating. The way in which the company responded to that, people retrained themselves overnight, you know, worked through the night, reshifted new shift patterns. People came from all over the place to come and manage that situation. So in that crisis, we did really well. And there are hundreds of examples. We 18 hospitals, we connected them, the new hospitals, these massive new hospitals, we connected them really, really rapidly. So we did well. So it's those kind of things, which I sort of knew already, the power of teams and the importance of leadership and providing assurance and reassurance to people that what they're doing is really, really important, and not to worry about stuff that's not important.
Let's talk about the telecom business more broadly. You mentioned that BT is a pretty systemically important company in the UK.
Yeah.
That's obviously now more true than ever, given the surge in demand with all of us Zooming and WebExing or whatever your favorite technology of choice is. How have you been able to manage those demands and navigate those demands? And how do you think about your role, you know, in the country, and how have you navigated the conversations with the government in terms of your systemically important role? Just interested in perspectives on that.
Yeah, I mean, so the BT, you know, is like an institution in the UK for all the historical reasons, and it got privatized in 1984. And we are linked into so many parts of the UK economy and infrastructure. So we've had to play a big role in helping the government and all these customers that we have stay connected. And therefore, the nature of what's been asked of us has changed dramatically. So at one level, obviously, everyone's working, many, many people are working from home. And so you've got a number of things going on there. One is you've got an increased demand for speeds. You've got an increased demand for capacity, and you've got a different profile of when it's happening in the time of day. And also call length has gone through the roof. So the average call is 50% higher than it was before. The biggest time for mobile calls used to be at commuter time, when people are on their way to work and on the way back. Well, that doesn't apply anymore, right? So mobile data is down about 10%. Fixed data is up masses, 50, 60, 70%, depending on time of day. And there are pockets of things that have changed around how people are using the network. So we've had to deploy a bit of funding to make sure that frankly the switches and the capacity is in the right place, which we did pretty quickly. And it's no more than, you know, tens of millions to fix that, because we had some of the places we were surprised by the pockets of and surge in demand. So we did that, and actually we managed to maintain performance really well. And so looking forward, I think life's going to change dramatically and for everybody. I think we're not going back to what it was like before. So, you know, we've got some very big global customers, the European Central Bank, for example, Unilever, many of the banks in the UK, and they've got, you know, hundreds of thousands of people too, many of whom are working from home. And then you start saying, well, actually, security is really important. Another example would be healthcare. GPs in the UK have for years been trying to do virtual appointments online with video and assessments. That's leaped forward. Now all GPs in the UK can, if they want, manage an assessment online through video, and importantly, access patient records in a secure fashion and prescribe online, all in a seamless journey. We did that in about 4 weeks. We always could do it, but we just couldn't get the customer to mobilize. And we didn't get the right interaction with the customer. So there's lots of examples of those kind of things that are changing for us. And I think in the future, connectivity and the services that it can deliver will obviously be even more important than they are today. And they're pretty high up on people's list right now.
So one of the unique things I've often thought about BT is you serve large enterprise customers. You mentioned some of them, but you also serve individual customers and, you know, kind of small business customers. And so you've got a very broad purview. I'm interested in your thoughts on the small business community and the small business, you know, smaller end of the spectrum of your customer base. How are they doing? How are you serving them? What observations do you have? You know, how have you seen that kind of part of the economy evolve, and what's BT's role in helping them?
Yeah, so we have about a third of the SMEs in the UK are BT customers. And you know, I think all of us, you know, looking at the economic implications of what's happening in the future sort of few months, are worried about SMEs particularly. I think there are, you know, that sector is one area where I think everyone is concerned about. Therefore, we put some things in place to try and support our customers in the SME sector. Now, ironically, I thought we might see many failures in the SME sector as a result of what's happened. We've seen far less than I anticipated. And it's not because we put these extra activities in place, because actually we're a relatively small part of what people pay, you know, versus their rent, for example, and their wages. The government in the UK, like the US and other places, have put in a very, very strong system of support where you can furlough your workers and they still get 80% of their pay. There are loans and there are rent holidays being somehow organized for these people. So actually many SMEs, although they're struggling, they've got in many cases no revenue, they're still viable. The question is, when those schemes come off and there's no longer government support, and these numbers are massive, we're talking multi millions of people being paid for by the state cannot afford to keep doing that. When that comes off, we're expecting some real pressure on the SME sector. And therefore, what we're trying to do is to make sure we're there for people. But, you know, we're so essential because, any, you know, credit card payments are often go over our lines by definition. So you can't not have a connection if you're going to take any business. So what we're doing is making sure we're there to help them on funding. And if they can't pay their bill, roll it over for a period of time, extend their contracts, all the stuff you'd expect to be a supportive provider of services. But again, you know, we've got big customers who are going through tough times. British Airways is a big customer of ours. The airline business, as we all know, completely decimated. Where's that going to go over the next 6 months, right? 9 months, a year. In a year's time, no one in the airline business would believe they're going to be back at the rate they were pre-coronavirus. So who knows? So I think that's again, the uncertainty surrounding what we're talking about now is massive for people. And we want to make sure we do our best for the SMEs wherever we possibly can.
Yeah, no, those are great comments, Phil. We feel the same. You know, globally, the SME community is the community that I think is most at risk. You know, the larger companies obviously facing a lot of pressure, but they have resources and they have capacity. The smaller businesses, yeah. You know, companies like ours need to do what we can, and you're obviously playing an enormously important role, which I know is super important in the UK. Can I just ask you about digital infrastructure? You and I have talked a lot about 5G and about the, you know, the future of broadband and how, you know, how things evolve over time. But one of the things this crisis is teaching us is just how the infrastructure we have is reacting to, yeah, you know, to surge in volumes. And you mentioned a little bit, but just interested in your view almost architecturally around, you know, the broadband infrastructure as we have it today and where you see it going and what we've learned or what you've learned in this period of time, you know, in terms of that infrastructure.
Yeah, I think overall, I think that, you know, the network has been tested in a way that no one would have anticipated before, in the surges that we talked about and the pockets of activity that no one would have expected. So I think the good news is the network has held up pretty well, but it's also underlined that people do need and will want faster speeds and more capacity. So you know, BT is investing very, very heavily in digital infrastructure in the UK. It's full fiber to the premise. We announced last week that we're gonna connect 20 million homes to full fiber in the next 5-6 years, and we'll probably keep going on that, probably to get to a footprint of maybe 26 or so at some stage. So we're building heavily on full fiber. We're leading on 5G too. So we're outright leader on 5G in the UK. And we're going to double down again on that in the next 12 months to double our coverage on 5G to create the best converged network. So the BT is putting massive investment in, because we know that it's important today, underlined by the crisis, but it's going to get more important. And I think the new world, in maybe it's 10 years time, maybe it's 8, who knows, could be 12, but there's going to be devices and sensors and drones everywhere. And the connectivity is going to be really important. And so to take the healthcare example, home monitoring will be in 5 years, definitely, but 10 years will be off the scale. Will be contributing to the economics of healthcare provision to try and redress that balance, which is really hard to manage right now. So connectivity is going to be crucial. The challenge with BT is to get a return on all that investment because we don't charge on data usage. So the business for BT, it's a great business, delivering outstanding service to many, many customers that we've talked about. The business model has some challenges because the data usage is growing at 40% today. I think that trend is going to definitely continue. Do I know exactly what the percentages are? No. But it's going to grow very, very fast for many, many years to come. And therefore, the new digital infrastructure is required. BT needs to find a way of repositioning itself to make a return in the right way and deliver new stuff and services. And the healthcare example is a flavor of what's to come, I think.
So how do you, on that basis, which I completely agree with, how do you think about the pace of 5G investment on a global basis and who can afford to do that and get a return on it and how shareholders are going to be broadly defined, you know, how patient are they going to be in terms of the scale of the spend and the ability for companies like yours to generate return?
Yeah, I mean, that's the key question. I think it's a really challenging question for shareholders and for all companies facing into these investments. And of course, the difficult thing is, you know, for BT and many companies in the telecoms world, we're making investments all at the same time. So it's full fiber, you know, which is not an insignificant amount of money for us. I'd say it's £12 billion plus 5G at the same time. You've got change in vendors and we've got to change our supplier base as well. So that's an extra cost. And BT in its own backyard is re-engineering the company itself. And we're embracing new technology and investing in that as well within the BT. So you've got every telco is facing that same sort of surge of investment requirements. And my personal view is that we have to do them. The question is, how can we get to the returns on it as quickly as possible? And there are things that are on the horizon that I think are interesting. So 5G specifically around enterprise, there are things that 5G will provide in the enterprise space on campuses, virtual private networks in the new world, I think could be very, very exciting, providing efficiencies for companies in distribution, in manufacturing that we can't get at today. So I think 5G could be more compelling for enterprises than it may be for consumers. But it takes time. And that's the real challenge and always has been for telco. You invest up front and then you wait for things to arrive. And unfortunately, sometimes they don't arrive ever. And sometimes they don't arrive quick enough. And that's the perennial challenge of telcos.
Before we wrap, I want to ask you a couple just closing personal comments and or questions.
Yeah.
And I want to, you and I both have a lot of kids.
We do.
And so, you know, I know you personally quite well, and I know that you are a really good father and you care a lot about work-life balance. But you're obviously very, very busy as we all are right now, and you've got your hands full.
Yeah.
Just talk about maybe a little bit how it's going now in the crisis, but more broadly, how you think about work-life balance and how you've tried to manage it in your own, you know, in your own way.
Sure. Well, I'm glad you think I'm a good father. I'm not so sure my kids would agree with that, but I hope so. But look, I think like all of us, we take it very, very seriously, right? In terms of a most important thing to all of us are our families and our loved ones, right? And I'm the same as you and the same as everyone probably listening on this video, right? So I guess, you know, what I've done is, I've thought long and hard about my own personal well-being, because if as the leader of a company, you know, what you don't want is to wobble. So, you know, and pretending you are invincible and not feeling the pressures of what's happening around you is a schoolboy error in my mind. So I accept that we're all under huge pressure here, dealing with uncertainties that are very, very difficult to manage. But we will get out of it, and I know we'll get out of it. I just don't know exactly when, but we will work our way out of it. So that's the first thing I say. I take my own advice, which is I think about my own well-being. And I insist that my team do the same. So I do want to understand how they're feeling and how they are thinking about things. And everybody goes through ups and downs. So we all do. So if I look at my team, they go ups and downs. And I want to try and be there for them when they're going through the downs, et cetera, et cetera. And it's no different with families. I think I've got five kids like you. So I think looking at my kids, thinking about them, they're paramount to me, right? Obviously. So I think as a leader of a company and as a father, I think thinking about the people who you are responsible for, it is the biggest responsibility. And so for, as the leader of BTY, I said to you, I feel so humbled and makes me feel so pleased to be the leader of BT is because my people have responded so well. And I think, you know, again, for me personally, my family, you know, have taken this crisis very, very seriously. And I have to say that they have responded. They somehow get it. And despite it being miserable for everybody, they're just toughing it out. And we all have got to do that and be there for each other. And I feel like my friends, my family, my loved ones, we're all in this together. And I think everybody listening in, the most important thing is to congregate around the people you love because they give you the strength. And at the end of the day, the difficulty we've all got is the lack of interaction, right? The lack of ability to touch people, to hug people, to shake people's hands. That is the we are as human beings, we love interaction, and that is restricted and it's in short supply and it's very, very difficult. So seeking those people out is what I personally do to make sure that my work doesn't just dominate everything I'm doing. So I go out every day. I'm on my bike. Most days I will go out on my bike and I'll whiz round as fast as I can on my 20-mile circuit. It's those kind of things that matter, I think. And everyone's got to follow their own advice. And when you're struggling, put your hand up and admit it. And I don't have any problem saying that myself.
Well, Phil, I could keep going and ask you lots of questions, but I think that's a really good place to end. And so thank you very much for your time. Really appreciate it.
John, it's an absolute pleasure. I've enjoyed talking to you as ever. Thank you.
Appreciate it. Good health. Take care.